Yes. Do I have to click somewhere here?
No, no, you just start your presentation mode and...
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, so thank you very much, Yevgeny, for giving me the opportunity to present some, I have to admit, some older parts of my work. So about functional representations in vector symbolic architectures. And I give you first a brief overview. And I shall start with a summary of basic principles of vector symbolic architectures. So what is the essence of symbolic computation? And then I come to the so-called filler and role bindings. First for dealing with the decomposition of the symbolic structures. Then I talk about the tensor product representations for mapping symbolic structures onto vectorial representations. And here I come to my main topic, which is functional representations in this talk. And I have three particular examples for that, namely logical inference, the implementation of a very simple kind of shift register, and the most elaborated example would be a top-down parser, so a recognizer for context-free grammars. So when we look at symbolic computation, we are dealing with symbolic data structures and with symbolic processes or algorithms. And so let us start with symbolic data structures. We have very simple structures, which could be strings, so to say, a list of symbols. We can work with nested lists, with phrase structure trees, in particular in the framework of language processing. Then there are other structures like frames or feature value structures. And this is, so to say, the static part of the approach. And then we need dynamics as well, namely how symbolic structures are mapped onto other symbolic structures during language processing, for example, or during logical inferences. And this is usually done by means of algorithms. So in principle, we can talk about automata, mainly Turing machines, for example, or other kinds of cognitive architectures. Let us consider some particular examples. So a list would be mathematically a triple or a tuple of some variables. So for example, here we have a triple, an ordered triple with a symbol A in the first position, B in the second position, and then again A in the second, in the third position. A list can also be composed from lists. That leads us to the structure of nested lists. We can deal with frames or with feature value pairs, where we have a feature and then the next part in the list would be the corresponding value. We see that there is a correspondence between this kind of nested list and the tree that we can represent in this way here. And then of course we can have labeled trees where also the intermediary nodes in the tree are assigned to some symbols of our symbolic repertoire. And as a very basic idea of algorithmic behavior, we can think about a shift register. That is, we have a list ABA in the first instance of time, and then you see that the B is shifted to the left, and the A here is concatenated at the right end of the list. So we get a new list, BAA, and then we make another shift, getting AAB. And then, of course, it can be repeated secularly. And another more sophisticated example would be parsing. So we can think about processing the sentence, the dog chased the cat. And for that, we can design a context-free grammar consisting of two syntactic rules, that the start symbol of the grammar, the sentence becomes expanded into a subject noun phrase and a verbal phrase. And then the second rule, the verbal phrase becomes expanded into the finite verb and an object noun phrase. And then we have additionally lexical rules saying that the subject noun phrase might be the dog and the verb might be the verb chased. And finally, the object noun phrase might be the cat. And then the idea is, can we design an algorithm that is able to process the sentence here in the course of time, the dog chased the cat. And this, of course, is possible, namely in the so-called top-down architecture, where we start with the start symbol of the grammar. By applying rule number one, we get this phrase structure tree that the start symbol S is expanded into subject noun phrase and verbal phrase by means of the first rule. And then now we can apply rule number two, which means that we have to expand the verbal phrase here, and we get finally this tree here. And then additionally, we apply the lexical rules in order to attach the words in the sentence during parsing. This is, so to say, the symbolic side of our work. And of course, we all know in order to map these symbols into hyperdimensional vector spaces, we use binding and bundling. So the procedure is first of all to decompose the symbolic data structures into so-called filler and role bindings, then to represent the filler and the role symbols as some basis vectors in a vector space. And if this vector space is equipped with a scalar product, in order to compute what's the unbinding processes, we are dealing with the Hilbert space in general. And then we have these two operations. The fillers can be bound to roles by means of the tensor product representation. And then additionally, we can bundle filler role bindings together to form very complex symbolic data structures. And here we use the direct sum. Usually one uses the arithmetic sum in the vector space, but there's some evidence that the direct sum is a mathematically more appropriate construction for that. So let us consider one example. Looking at the list representation, we saw from the introduction, the list ABA, how do we get a filler role binding for that? Well, we see that the symbol A appears in the first position of the list. So we need a role for the first position in the list, and this is our role R1. Then we see that B appears in the second position, and the third A appears in the third position of the list. So we have here in this example only two fillers, A and B. These are our symbolic constituents. And then we have the three roles here, R1, R2, R3, denoting the positions in the list. And finally, we get the filler role binding by this mapping from the symbolic data structures into the Cartesian product of the atomic fillers and the roles. And you see here the result of the filler role binding is a set of ordered pairs, namely a set of ordered pairs where the first symbol A is bound to the first role, the symbol B is bound to the second role, and the A is bound to the third role again. The same procedure works for trees as well. So if we consider such a labeled tree here, we have our symbolic alphabet now comprising the terminal symbols A and B and the, so to say, a non-terminal symbol of a corresponding context free grammar S. And then you see the fillers are again our atomic symbols A, B, and S. And for roles, and there, of course, you can have different possibilities. You can use at binary descriptions, but also at this kind of trinary descriptions here. In most of our research, we use one rule for the mother position in the tree, another rule for the left daughter and the third rule for the right daughter. And this gives us the following recursive decomposition into a Fillerol decomposition. So we start with the left subtree, which is the tree S, A, and B. And this gives the corresponding Fillerol binding. You see S is bound to the mother rule, A is bound to the left daughter, and B is bound to the right daughter. And again, this Fillerol binding is a set of ordered pairs. So it is a power set, an element of the power set of the Cartesian product of F over F times R. The same works for the right subtree here, which is essentially the same as for the left subtree. And these are now so-called complex fillers, which can be bound to roles again in the in order to get the entire tree. And then you see the entire tree is given as S is bound to the mother role. The complex filler for the left subtree is bound to the left daughter, and the complex filler for the right subtree is bound to the right daughter. And then, of course, you can iterate these Fillerol bindings, and then essentially you can decompose arbitrary complex symbolic data structures in such a way that you get sets of ordered pairs, of sets of ordered pairs, and so on and so on. So, of course, we have to deal with recursion. That means formally that we identify our atomic fillers with the simple fillers at the zero level in our description here. And then we identify the complex fillers at level n plus one as the power set of fillers of the level n bound to all the roles. And finally, we unify all these levels here, and then we take also the roles into account in order to get such description of symbolic Fillerol bindings. And the Fillerol binding is now a mapping from the symbolic data structures into this recursively defined set F infinity. Well, this is the decomposition of our symbolic data structures, of course, and probably most of you know about that. Then we have to map these decompositions, these Fillerol bindings, onto vectors in a vector space, in hyperdimensional vector space. And this is usually achieved by means of tensor product representations. And here we have essentially to deal with two operations, that is the tensor product. And here I will simplify things by saying that the tensor product of two vector spaces, V and W, is defined by the so-called Kronecker outer product, which means that the tensor product of two vectors, here defined as in this that way, is obtained simply by creating a new vector where the second vector here is multiplied by means of the scalar multiplication with the elements of the first vector. And then you see, as a result, you get a vector again, because usually in the outer product, the product of two vectors will be a matrix. But here, which is called the Kronecker product, you map vectors by means of the tensor product onto vectors again. And this procedure has been interestingly used very quite early by Eduardo Mizrahi at the end of the 80s, essentially at the same time when Paul Smolensky has discovered his own framework of tensor product and Fillerol bindings. And then, of course, we can use the direct sum of two vector spaces, where we usually speak about the so-called outer direct sum of two vector spaces, which is given by this kind of zero padding here. So we take the vectors of the first vector space and enlarge this vector by zero padding to get the right dimension. And then we do the same for the second vector, and then the result of this operation, the outer sum is the outer direct sum is this vector here in a higher dimensional vector space, of course. And finally, we can compute the tensor product representation. So here in a more formal way, given a Fuller-Rolle binding given by this map from the symbolic data structure into this recursively defined Fuller-Rolle bindings, we define a mapping psi from this space into some vector space by these four propositions. That the image of the fillers is a subspace called the filler space of this vector space. The image of the set of roles is another subspace of this vector space. And then crucially, if you have two subsets in this set of symbolic data structures, subsets A and B, and we compute the image of the unification of A and B, then we have to apply the direct sum here. And if we have complex filler represented by a set A bound to a role R, we have to use the tensor product here. And if we look at the recursive structure of this space of the set F infinity, again, we see that the resulting vectors become an element of this vector space here. And you can simply prove that this is a subspace of a more general vector space where we take the direct sum of the filler space and the role space, and then we compute arbitrary tensor products. So the tensor powers to n, and then we compute the direct sum over all the n's. And this is a very well-known construction in quantum field theory that is known as the Fock space. Paul Smolensky has emphasized on this quite a lot. And so we know that this structure used in quantum field theory known as the Fock space. Well, now we are able to compute particular representations because the fillers and the roles can be chosen from different vector spaces. And in the most simple representation, we know that the number fields of a vector space are vector spaces itself. And so we can restrict to number fields, and then the resulting Fuller-Rolle bindings would be the so-called Gödel representations. Then we can of course use arithmetic vector spaces, which lead then to finer dimensional vector symbolic architectures, which can be implemented as neural networks, for example. We can also combine Gödel representations and arithmetic representations to obtain the so-called fractal representations, which is work, for example, by Whitney Tabor, who constructed these fractal automata in his work. And finally, and this is of course the topic of my presentation tonight, we can look at function spaces. And of course, function spaces are vector spaces of infinite dimensionality. And these are called functional representations. And as arithmetic spaces can be implemented by neural networks, functional representations can be implemented by so-called dynamic fields or neural field architectures. And I will give examples for this at the end of my presentation as well. So let us consider our examples again. The simplest example that we had already was the list processing or the representation of lists. And then you see having a list with symbols A and B, we can simply compute the vector images. So we have a vector A as an image, as the image of the symbol A, and a vector B as the image of the symbol B. We can also compute the images of the role vector, of the role positions to get vector roles, and then the rules of Fuller-Rolle binding entail that the image of the list AVA is simply A bound to the first row vector plus B bound to the second row vector plus A bound to the third row vector. And this can be done, of course, in arbitrary vector spaces, so in the number field, in an arithmetic vector space, or in a function space. But what does this mean in particular? So let me motivate the introduction of dynamic fields or neural field theory here. If we consider a neural network, we know that we have a finite number of neurons. So we have a unit 1, 2, and 3, and these neurons can have different activation values. And then of course, if all the neurons in our neural network have different activation values, we know that the total activation of the neural network becomes a vector in this vector space of activation vectors here. This is, so to say, the standard description of activation in a neural network. But of course, and this has been emphasized, for example, by Wolfram Erlhagen and Gregor Schöner, that there is a completely different way to looking at activation vectors in neural networks. And this is related to sampling, discrete sampling of functions. So instead of constructing an orthonormal basis of activations here, which leads to our representation in a vector space, we can draw the activation of the first unit at one line here, and in parallel to that, we can draw the activation of the second unit here, and then we can draw the activation of the third unit here. And all these units are aligned in parallel, but perpendicular to an additional space. And this, you see immediately, gives us a kind of a discrete sampling of a function that could in principle be continuous. And the additional dimension that we had to introduce here is the so-called feature space. That means that all the activations here are perpendicular to this newly introduced feature space. And this is simply now, if we make the continuum limit from a discrete sampling to a function space, you see that instead of talking about indices of these components here, we get a continuous variable here as the position in our feature space. Now again, we have described the static representation, mapping Fuller-Rolle bindings to activation vectors in a neural network or to functions in a neural field. But then of course, we need some possibility to describe the dynamics as well. And in this representation space, dynamics becomes a kind of what you see here. This is basically the example of our shift register that we have one activation vector here, one point in our representation space that becomes attractive from our initial condition here. And then during the process of computation, we need another attractor, namely the result of our computation. And therefore, usually in our representation space, we have attracting and repulsing directions. And this means that the intermediary steps of our symbolic computation become saddle points in our representation space. And so in order to implement the dynamics in our hyperdimensional computation, we are usually working with kind of saddle dynamics. And this kind of saddle dynamics is straightforwardly introduced by this concept of order parameter decomposition. And that means that we have here our representation vectors residing from the tensor product representation at the successive time steps of our computation. And we now multiply these vectors by time-dependent amplitudes. And then we sum over all these weighted vectors in order to get a function, namely an activation vector depending on time. And by using a particular choice for these time-dependent amplitudes, we can straightforwardly implement the desired saddle dynamics in the residing vector space. So in that way, we would be able to obtain a continuous time dynamics in our representation space, in general in the Fock space, residing from the tensor product representation. Well, let me look at some particular examples. The first example would be logical inference. So that means we have two variables, A and B. We can have this truth table here that saying that if A and B are both zero for the equivalence function, the result would be one. If either A is zero and B is one, or B, A is one and B is zero, we would obtain as the result zero. And in case that the inputs A and B are both one, we again obtain one as the output. So the input strings A and B should be represented in some way as functional tensor products. And this can be done in the following way. First of all, we use a mapping of the symbols onto functions. And the most straightforward way is to use constant functions here. So again, the variables can have values 0 and 1. So we have a binary alphabet. We simply deal with binary numbers here. And then the function A over a feature space X would be simply the constant function 0. And the filler vector, so to say, the filler function B, depending on X, would be simply the constant function one. This is a very simple representation for the fillers, namely as constant functions. But now for the rules, we choose a more sophisticated representation, namely Gaussian bumps. So that means we introduce as a feature space here, the space that is indicated by our continuous variable y. And then we have one Gaussian bump centered around one position in the feature space, representing the first filler, the first rule in the list, for example. And we have another bump centered at another point in our feature space, representing the second rule in our filler rule decomposition. And then, of course, we straightforwardly obtain the tensor product representation, which is basically the scalar multiplication of the constant functions representing the fillers with these Gaussian bumps representing the rules. And then you see, of course, A can be a variable that is either one or zero. B is another variable being either one or zero. And then additionally, we introduce here a gating variable for the reason you will see immediately, the gating pulse, because now we want to implement this kind of function and the resulting dynamics behind that as a neural field. So a continuous neural network, and for that one usually uses so-called Amari dynamic field equation. And this network, this neural field can be trained by a modification of the HAP rule, which is a regularized HAP rule using Tikhonov regularization. And here is the result. So again, we have two variables, A and B. These take binary values, either 0 and 1. And here you see again the corresponding functional representation. And here you see now the y direction is the y-axis here in this representation. And then we introduce another feature direction, another feature dimension, which is x here. And this we need in order to implement the processing of the algorithm. And what we are using here is position A. So it's A, Gaussian bump centered at site A, corresponding to the presence of the variable A, or either 0 or 1. Then we have here position B. If there's a Gaussian gap bump appearing or not, it's defined by the appearance of the variable B here. And then here we have this gating variable. So in this case, A is 1, A is 0 and B is 0. So we don't have any input here at A and B, but only a gating variable. And connectivity, the synaptic connectivity in this dynamic field has been chosen in such a way that we implement computation by lateral inhibition. And what you see is here, if there are no inputs in A and B, the gating pulse simply propagates into the output destination C, and that means that we have output one in this scenario. Now consider A is zero, which simply means that there is no Gaussian bump in the A position, but there is one input in B. That means here now we have a Gaussian bump. And this travels along the x direction here. It encounters the gating pulse here. And because the synaptic connectivity is chosen in such a way to have lateral inhibition, both pulses annihilate which is each other, and there is no output in C. Then again, one in the A dimension, that means here is a Gaussian bump. Then we have no B position, but they have, we have still the gating pulse. And at some point in time, both pulses propagate to a point where they again annihilate to each other, and there is no output in C. But finally, if A and B are both one, you see A is one here and B is one there, and the gating pulse is again here, and you see that A and B are annihilating quite early during their propagation, and only the gating pulse travels through to the output, and then we obtain the desired result here. So this is a very simple example for a functional representation. Another example, a bit more intricate, would be our shift register. But again, here we use simple, simple binary code for the fillers. So we map the symbol A to 0 and the symbol B to 1. But now, instead of Gaussian bumps, we use sign functions as the roles, indicating the position in a list. And then you see here we have this blue line for the first position in the list, a sine function of frequency one. Then we have this red line for the second position, namely simply a oscillation with frequency two. Sorry, that was with the green line, of course. And then finally, we have the third row position, which is the function here with frequency four. This is, you see immediately, we multiply the sine functions here with the corresponding fillers, and then we get, and then we compute the sum over all these products, and this is basically a Fourier series. So therefore, we may call this the Fourier code for a functional representation. And now again, we have to look at the temporal dynamics. And a very simple way to implement this kind of saddle behavior in the representation space would be to have one amplitude for the first pattern, which decreases until it becomes zero. Then we have another amplitude for the second pattern, which approaches the maximum at time one here, and then it decreases again until becoming zero. And finally, we have a third function, a third amplitude, starting here at point one, and then increasing over the last steps of our computation. And again, we have this binary code for the fillers A and B in our NIST processing. We use three sine functions with different spatial frequencies over this additional feature space here. And then you see the tensor product representation in function space of the list ABA becomes the image of the symbol A. So the result is the number zero times the first sine wave plus the value for B, namely one, times the second sine wave plus A again times the third sine wave. And you see, of course, because these are binary numbers, we simply obtain the sine wave with frequency four in this case. And again, we use the Y axis here as our feature space. You see here at the beginning, we have a sine wave with one hill and one throw here. And then at time t, we have a doubling of the frequency. And at time two, we have a fourth times of the frequency here. So this is the temporal dimension now implemented by these piecewise linear functions I have introduced before. And again, we want to train a dynamic field architecture with this spatial temporal dynamics, the spatial dimension encoding the Fuller-Hole representation, the tensor product representation, and the temporal dynamics encoding the algorithm, in this case, simply the shift register. And of course, again, using a simple Hab rule, in this case here, using more Penrose regularization does not help that much. We have to regularize, and then of course, using the Tekonov regularization, we perfectly can recapitulate the patterns that have to be learned here by our algorithm. So this would be, so to say, the first three steps of our shift register in a functional representation. And the most complicated example would be trees, of course. I have presented this before. The tensor product representation for a tree would be again the filler vector for the start symbol bound to the Mazur rule plus the filler vector for the symbol A bound to the left daughter plus the filler vector for B bound to the right daughter. And what can we use for a functional representation? Is there an appropriate function space? Is there an appropriate feature space? And what I have realized, you see in this paper in 2009, is that we can use spherical harmonics for the representation of trees. So a spherical harmonic is a function in a three-dimensional space that is parameterized by three variables, namely the radius, the polar angle, and the azimuth angle. And this is used for the rule vectors. And then, of course, we need a functional representation for the filler vectors. And these are the images of our terminal, non-terminal variables of the context-free grammar I have given before. And in that case, we use very simple oscillations. So again, we have a frequency representation for the fillers. You see here, functions depending on time are representing the grammatical categories, namely by means of harmonic oscillations of different temporal frequencies. But then again, we need a representation of the role vectors or of the role functions. And what came to my mind is that we can use a kind of term schema, also known in quantum physics here, that we identify the mother role of the tree with this midterm here, which means we use the spherical harmonics in, parameterized by the indices 1 and 0. And then we can encode the left daughter of the tree by the corresponding spherical harmonic with this characterization, and the right daughter of the tree by the spherical harmonic with this combination. So these are spherical harmonics, which are given by products of spatial frequencies and the so-called Legendre polynomials. And how does such a functional representation look like? Again, we use radial waves in our case, in one case, for example, here, functions depending on the radius here instead of time for the fillers. And again, spherical harmonics depending on the two angles of our functional representation here. And then, of course, how can we compute tensor products in the function space? And this basically means that we compute functions point-wise, but with different arguments. So you see here the tensor product of a function of a filler function fi and a role function yjm, depending on arguments r, theta, and phi, becomes the point-wise product of the function fi depending on r and the spherical harmonic depending on the two angle functions here. This is tensor product in the function space. Point-wise multiplication, but of course on different arguments. And here's the particular instance that we have used in this case. So we use the radius dimension of our feature space for encoding the fillers. And we use the spherical harmonics, and you probably know these are the solutions of the quantum mechanical Schrödinger equation for the hydrogen atom. We use this spherical harmonic, this orbital function, so to say, for the mother role, this orbital for the left daughter, and this orbital for the right daughter. And now the crucial point is, of course, in this lecture series, we were always dealing with the curse of dimensionality, so with the combinatorial explosion. And of course, we have seen in the last lectures that there are technical ways, numerical ways to deal with this curse of dimensionality. But in a function space, we don't have to consider that as a problem at all, because our function space is infinite dimensional, of course. And of course, for a numeric implementation, we have to use high dimensional spaces. But in principle, mathematically, these function spaces are infinite dimensional. But on the other hand, as I said, a tensor product in function space involves an multiplication of arguments of these functions. So again, apparently there could be a kind of curse of dimensionality now concerning the feature spaces instead of the dimensionality of the vector space. But fortunately, in the function spaces that we can usually employ here, we have recursion rules. And in particular, for the spherical harmonics, we have very nice recursions saying that the tensor product of two spherical harmonics becomes or can be developed into a linear combination of other spherical harmonics with higher frequencies, with higher spatial frequencies. So this is the solution of the curse of dimensionality, of the curse of dimensionality in function space. Simply replacing more and more arguments in these functions by higher spatial frequencies. And as a result, as I said, we want to apply this to our top-down parser. We obtain this very simple spherical representation, functional representation, where only the start symbol is bound to the mother role. Then we have another tree here, which can be obtained by applying the rule one of the grammar. And you see here the corresponding fillers are represented as temporal oscillations. The corresponding rules are represented as spherical harmonics here. And finally, we obtain this pattern here for the entire tree. But now again, we want to have also continuous time for our computation. And this means we introduce this kind of saddle dynamics here. You're starting with this attractor here. And then we have an attracting direction for this point and a repulsing direction giving rise to this attractor here. And then again, attracting in this direction and repelling in this direction. We can combine all this, all these different kinds of dynamics to get this picture for our top-down parsing process. And so you see, this is the potential of functional representations dealing with infinite dimensional vector spaces and using feature spaces for encoding the indices, so to say, of our vectors. And that's all I have to present today. Thank you very much for your attention.
Peter, thank you very much for this exciting talk. Indeed, lots of thoughts awakened. Okay, now I'm opening the floor for questions.
I have a question. So you use the tensor product in these Fock spaces to represent the compound objects. Right. Could you also use a binding operation which is dimensionality preserving and do the same thing and kind of make this easier? I mean, at least conceptually.
Could you explain a bit more? What do you mean by this kind of binding?
Yeah, right now, if you encode a tree, also form these pairs, right, of filler role pairs. Yes. You use as the binding operation the tensor product.
Yes, of course.
And so this gets you into a higher dimensional representation space every time you have a more complicated object.
That's true.
The question is, could you replace here the tensor product binding with Hadamard product or a circular distribution binding?
Of course, in principle you can, but this is a field that we have not studied in that detail yet. One of the advantages of the very abstract description in the Fock space is, of course, you have to deal with linearly independent filler and role vectors. But as a result of that, you can prove representation theorems. You can rigorously prove representation theorems. And this, at the current stage, is not possible for using this kind of dimension reduction. And then of course, one have to think about how to further develop this theory of Fock space to such alternative binding operations. In principle, you can consider these kind of binding operations as composites of tensor products and subsequent compression.
Right.
And then, of course, you have to develop a theory about that. And
yeah,
that would be really interesting research topic, but so far we don't have a theory for that.
Okay, thanks.
Any more questions? Well, maybe I can fit in my little question here. Well, I understood from your talk how one construct these compositional structures, mm-hmm. but if you want to extract a certain variable, say, I mean, a certain child from a tree, so a certain level of recursion, I mean, how should you proceed with functional representations in this way?
Yeah, of course, you need these unbinding procedures. And therefore, and of course, you need a Hilbert space structure. You have to use a scalar product or some kind of adjoint operation. But these are fortunately already given in the corresponding function spaces. So all the function spaces I have used so far are Hilbert spaces, and there you have the unbinding operation as well. But of course, well, yes, of course, instead of computing a scalar product in the usual way, you have to compute integrals over some kernel functions in the function spaces. It's a bit more complicated, of course. And so far, therefore, at the current stage, it's a quite nice theory, but we don't have that much evidence from the numeric side of course yet.
Did you apply this theory for solving some, say, large-scale problems?
No, not yet. No, unfortunately not.
So, more questions from the audience?
I mean, maybe a comment. I mean, yeah, it's very interesting. So we are currently just finishing a paper where we actually make the connection to kernel theory. And I could actually present this in a few weeks, Evgeny, if we are just finishing up a paper which will go on archive. And it's very interesting. So it's a longer discussion, but it's a very interesting relation to these neural fields.
Right.
I look forward for your presentation. So just give me a sign when you're ready.
Yeah, thanks, will do.
Maybe one more question. So it's kind of intriguing to think about it, but the choice of functions, yes. I mean, for representing roles and fillers for different problems. So how much, well, it looks now that it's very manual kind of selection. So you need to really understand all the functions. So is there any easy way, I mean, for non-mathematicians to get started or select these functions?
Well, yes, of course. So let me come back to my very first example. And that was here this logical inferences, and what usually, as I've said, usually you are introducing these Gaussian bumps over this feature space here, and there's a very well developed theory about that, related to the researchers Wolfram Erhagen and Gregor Schöner. And this makes the distinction, I would say, between neural fields in general and dynamic fields. Because in dynamic field theory or in dynamic field applications, and there are a lot of applications, particularly from these researchers or for in robotics, for example, as well. And that means that you are restricting your dynamic field architectures to these bump solutions, and therefore you also have to look at a very special kind of synaptic connectivities for implementing the algorithms. And that means basically you have kind of Mexican head connectivity for your neural field. And then you are looking at these Gaussian bump solutions. And then you can devise algorithms, how to stabilize and destabilize these Gaussian bumps. And this is very much advanced today. So there's an entire research field with applications in robotics and language processing and all that. And there, so you see, it's quite straightforward. Any times I want to represent some symbol bound to some filler, I use this spatially located Gaussian bump. And anything more to say? Yeah, well.
Yeah, I've got an idea, it. Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's it, really. That's very straightforward. You don't have to develop sophisticated solutions of your neural field equations, like in my last example. It was really by accident that I have recognized that this quantum mechanical term schema can be used to represent a binary branching tree. That was really by accident. It's really straightforward.
Yeah, but it's all very exciting. So maybe an opportunity for a last minute question from the audience. All right. If not, then I would like to thank Peter once again for joining us tonight, for us in Europe tonight. And I look forward for more exciting talks on our webinar series. So if you have suggestions for future talks, please drop me a line. Thank you very much, everybody, for attending.
I thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Yes, and see you next time. See you.
See you next time.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
See you. Bye-bye.